height has a lot to do with it too. If the plane were on the ground, I'd be a lot happier.
Okay. All right. The part of the brain where emotions are triggered is the right side of the brain. That's where you have images being processed. So the left side of the brain processes words, and words come in one at a time in a sequence. So the logic on the left side of the brain is sequential logic. And when people say logical thinking, what they mean is left brain thinking. But the right brain has its form of logic too, and it's valid, but it's instantaneous logic, and psychologists call it intuitive logic. You just see things and you just know certain things. It's too much fun, it's too easy, so we don't think of it as work. It's the way we drive a car or play baseball. The ball comes at you, you just know what to do. Okay. And that kind of knowledge when it comes to the airplane gets us into trouble, because visual logic, we could describe it as seeing is believing. And when you see the airplane up there, you can see that it's big. And you know that something's that big is really heavy. And what's holding it up?
Air.
But you can't see air. And if you do this, you say, come on, this can't hold up an airplane. So what can hold up an airplane? Well, Bernoulli's theorem. The problem with Bernoulli's theorem is it's too left brain. And although it makes sense to the left side of the brain, that's not where the emotions are controlled. So we need to come up with something that the right visual brain can see that's holding the airplane up. And how can we do that since you can't see air? If you get in a car and you go down the road at about 50 miles an hour and put your hand out the window and push forward, it takes about the same force as putting your hand down in a swimming pool and pushing forward. So air at 50 miles an hour is about as thick as water, and at about 100 miles an hour, about as thick as molasses, and at about 150 miles an hour, as thick as Jello. Well, see, molasses won't stand up, nor will water, but Jello will stand up. As you know, when you have Jello dessert, you look in the Jello, and it's probably holding a piece of pineapple. So the idea is, if we can replace that piece of pineapple with a little airplane, you can see that it's held solidly on all sides. That's the way air is. And to maybe explain it a little bit more, when the airplane first starts to roll down the runway, the air is like this. It's not going to slow the airplane down. And if you look at the speed indicator, it's going 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, even faster than I can say it. When you get to about 50 miles an hour, it's 51, 52, 53, 54. When you get to 100, it's 101, 102, 103, because the air is getting thicker. It can't accelerate as fast because the air is getting thicker and thicker. At 150, it's 150, 151, 152, 153. Now, at this point, air is about as thick as Jello. But it's also interesting to go back to 1946 when Chuck Yeager and other pilots were trying to fly the X-1 faster than the speed of sound. And they would get the airplane right up to the edge of the speed of sound, and it wouldn't accelerate anymore. And they started to think maybe air becomes a solid at the speed of sound. Maybe it becomes like a rock and it's impenetrable, okay? As it turned out, they finally did get through the speed sound barrier, but the acceleration as you approach it gets to be very slow, and past the speed of sound, it is so slow it is just boring. When I was flying the F-100, one of the things that they had us do in training was to go supersonic. And we thought, wow, tomorrow we're going to go supersonic. That's going to be really exciting. It was the most boring flight I ever did, because once you get to that speed with the airplane, your speed is increasing like 702, 703, and all you're doing is watching it on the instruments. There's just nothing happening. So that's how thick air gets. So if you think about takeoff speed, the air's like Jello. It's holding the airplane solidly there. Okay, and we could play with this a little bit. If you could imagine going down to the grocery store, buying some Jello and powder, and buying a little model airplane about this big. You come home, mix up your Jello, put it in the fridge, and then take your little airplane and put it in the middle of the Jello. Then after a few hours, you take it out and take that big hunk of Jello and put it on your kitchen table. And what you've got there is a model of aerodynamics at about 150 miles an hour. And the airplane is just held there in the Jello. Now, let's say your Jello is 12 inches high. The airplane's sitting at 6 inches. My science teacher told me that the atmosphere is 12 miles from top to bottom. So when planes cruise around 30-some thousand feet, you're halfway up in the Jello, held there solidly. Now, at 150 miles an hour, sitting in your kitchen table, that's that snapshot. You've got snapshot of 150, Jello speed. You're going to go faster than that. The engines are going to push the airplane forward through the Jello. And we can simulate that with some shish kebab skewers. Come in from behind the airplane, put the tips of the shish kebab skewers against the engines and shove the airplane forward. And as you do, if the airplane nose is level, it doesn't get any higher in the Jello, doesn't get lower. But if you raise the nose a little bit and push it forward through the Jello, what's it going to do? It's going to slightly rise as it goes forward. Okay. Yeah. People worry about what they've heard of as air pockets. There's no such thing as an air pocket. The airplane can't fall. What happens is, and let's say you're back in your kitchen and someone comes in and you say, here, put your hand on top of the Jello and pat on the Jello or squeeze it down up ahead of where my airplane is. When we're on the radio, we hear other airplanes ahead of us talk about this turbulence ahead. Sometimes we can change altitudes and get above it or below it. But if we can't change and find an altitude that's smoother, as we get to that place where the Jello is moving up and down, it's going to cause the airplane to move up and down because the Jello is being compressed. And that's all the turbulence is. Except that it feels like a bump rather than just a smooth climb and descent. That's only because of the speed. See, if you took your car to the edge of a speed bump, if you go across it at 10 miles an hour, it's a very solid bump. But if you just come to the edge of it and let your car just climb it slowly and down the other side, then it's not very much of a bump. Similarly, if you were in a hot air balloon and you floated over to a cloud where there's air moving up and down and up and down, the balloon would just rise gently and gracefully and then descend gently and just like this, be perhaps rather pleasant. But an airplane zipping through there doesn't feel it that way. It's like hitting a speed bump. It goes bam. Now, so let's imagine a speed bump about 3 inches. And you hit it with your car at 10 miles an hour, it really jolts your car. Now, if it was a 1-inch speed bump, you probably could hit it at about 50 and get the same jolt. And if it was a 1/2 inch, maybe at 100. If it was a 1/4 inch, 200, or an 1/8 inch, about 400. So when an airplane is hitting a really solid bump, it's moving somewhere between an 1/8 and a 1/16 inch. That's all. But it feels like so much more. Did you ever play croquet when you were a kid?
Yep.
In croquet, I think it's called sending your partner. Maybe you know, I don't know, but it's where you take the ball and you put it against your opponent's ball and you put your foot on yours. And then you hit your ball and your ball only moves about 1/16 of an inch. And then it zips off your opponent's ball. But your ball moves that 1/16 of an inch very fast because you're hitting it with your mallet, maybe 50 miles an hour, moves your ball initially 50 miles an hour and then stops it, but it sends the other person's ball off at 50 miles an hour. So here the airplane goes along, and it hits a bump at 500 miles an hour and goes up 500 miles an hour, about this much. And people in the airplane, like the opponent's ball, they move around quite a bit. And so you think, if I'm moving 2 or 3 feet, the airplane must be moving 2 or 3 miles, but it's just the opposite.